me on a cool day, a hot day, a wet day, whichever one you choose. Try to kiss me on a gray day, a May day, a pay day, and see if I refuse. And if you make it on a bleak day, a freak day, a weak day, well, you can be my guest. But never, never on a Sunday, a Sunday, the one day I got to get some rest. Most any day, you can be my guest. Any day you say, put my day of rest. You can kiss me on a Tuesday. In fact, I wish you would. You can kiss me on a Wednesday, a Thursday, a Friday. Saturday is best. Never, never on a Sunday, a Sunday, the one day I got to get my rest. Potatoes. A fine romance you won't nestle. A fine romance you won't wrestle. I might as well play bridge with my old maid aunts. I haven't got a chance. This is a fine romance. You take romance, I'll take jello. You're calmer than the seals in the Arctic Ocean. At least they flap their fins to express emotion. A fine romance with no quarrels. A fine romance. It's all morals. I've never muffed a crease in your blue serge pants. I never get the chance. This is a fine romance. A fine romance, my dear. This is too old. Fogies, we need kisses. We two should be like clams in a dish of chowder. But we just fizz like yesterday's Sedlitz powder. A fine romance with no clinches. A fine romance. know. Pinches, you're just as hard to land as the Ile-de-France. I haven't got a chance. This is a fine romance. This affair is absolutely ridiculous.
Lena Horne with three facets of her sparkling presence. First on a wonderful day like today, and then never on Sunday, with more sexual innuendo in 4 minutes than in the entire film about a Grecian lady who would only walk the streets 6 days a week. And lastly, a fine romance delivered as only Lena Horne could and did. Unless I'm mistaken, the coming year will see Lena's 84th birthday, and I hope that she has many, many more to come. So, my friends, it's nearly 10 hours to go before Big Ben chimes in a new year, at least for us in the United Kingdom. So let us remember, here and now, how Bing Crosby once greeted the moment in a film.
One minute to midnight, 1 minute to go, 1 minute to say goodbye before we say hello. Let's start the new year right, 12 o'clock tonight, when they dim the light, let's begin. Kissing the old year out, kissing the new year in. Let's watch the old year die with a fond goodbye, and our hopes as high as a kite. How can our love go wrong if we start the new year right? Watch the old year die with a fond goodbye, and our hopes as high as a kite. How can our love go wrong if we start the new year right?
Crosby with the New Year song from his film Holiday Inn, made in 1942. And that was just one of about seven Irving Berlin songs in that film, each of them allocated to a different holiday in the year. Easter Parade, White Christmas being just two, and Let's Start the New Year Right being a third. As the old year dies, we will spend time in our second hour together remembering some of the artists who left us during the past 12 months. But here and now, it's back to London, and Paul Layton for a summary of the news on 88 to 91 FM, Radio 2 from the BBC.
Thanks, Desmond. The Millennium Dome is due to close as a tourist attraction at 6 o'clock this evening, and it's ending its life as it began, surrounded by political controversy. The man responsible for running it, P.Y. Gabeau, says that with 6.5 million visitors, it's come to rank as the second most popular attraction in Europe behind Euro Disney. But the Conservatives have unveiled a poster portraying the dome as the lid of a dustbin. The Shadow Culture Secretary, Peter Ainsworth, outlined their message.
The poster says, what will Labour throw your money away on next? And here we see over £600 million of lottery money has been sunk into this project. They've bungled the operation of the dome for a whole year, and they're now bungling the sale of the dome. Even that seems to be in trouble and unlikely to generate what people want, which is some of their money back from this thing.
Three people have been found dead at their home in West Cumbria. The bodies of Peter and Joan Stone and their daughter Emma Jane were found by police at the house in Cleetham Moor yesterday. An investigation is underway into the cause of their deaths. A High Court judge, Dame Janet Smith, is to lead the public inquiry into the case of the serial killer Harold Shipman. The 54-year-old GP, who practised at Hyde in Greater Manchester, was convicted in January of murdering 15 of his elderly female patients. Detectives believe he may have been responsible for up to 200 murders. A date for the inquiry is expected to be announced this week. The former Conservative Cabinet Minister Michael Heseltine has launched a strong attack on bogus asylum seekers. He said politicians shouldn't be afraid to speak out about abuses of the immigration system. The Home Office says the number of asylum seekers are levelling off. This report from our political correspondent Nicholas Jones.
The former Deputy Prime Minister believes a serious problem is building up because of the uncontrolled flow into the country of bogus asylum seekers. Mr. Heseltine says it's right to ask the question, why on earth should British citizens go without the houses they want or take longer to get the treatment they need in order to make way for people who've cheated the immigration rules? Mr. Heseltine says he's always stood up for racial harmony, but his remarks point to the political advantage which Labour fear the Conservatives will seek to gain from the increase in refugees.
Severe weather is continuing to cause problems for travellers as more heavy snow is reported to be on the way. There's a warning that most of the country will be hit by blizzard conditions, with gale force winds sweeping in from the west. A man from Salisbury has been describing how a train journey, which should have taken about an hour, ended up taking more than 6 hours to complete. John Lakeman set out to catch a train from Bath to Salisbury at 8:30 in the evening. It was cancelled, as was the next train, which was also the last of the night. A replacement coach service left him on a deserted station in Wiltshire in the early hours of the morning, before a taxi finally dropped him off at his destination at 3 a.m. That's the BBC News. At 2:03, more at 3.
Oh, what it is to be at home and not on a train.
88 to 91 FM.
I'm Desmond Carrington in Scotland, back with you on
BBC Radio 2.
Thank God for the radio. When I'm on the road, when I'm far from home, feeling blue. Thank God for the radio.
Thank you.
God for the radio.
And so say all of us. Patsy Riggir, a country singer who usually writes her own material, but that song was an exception. Thank God for the radio. I don't think it does any harm to remind ourselves of what a marvel radio was when it first came into the home, and remains, of course, bringing familiar voices with it.
Little Betty Bouncer is kind to her people and a nice girl, more or less.
But at present, no joke, she's causing her folks no end of deep distress.
For she is quite mad about a man she's never met.
And it's all through an innocent crystal set.
Little Miss Bouncer loves an announcer down at the BBC.
She doesn't know his name, but how she rejoices when she hears that voice of voices.
Absolutely tireless, sitting at the wireless.
Poor little Miss B.
It's the man who announces with such a lot of passion in it.
The Daventry shipping forecast will follow in a minute.
Little Miss Bouncer loves an announcer down at the BBC.
She almost passes right away the silly little clown whenever he announces that the station's closing down.
You'd think from her behavior when he mentions oscillation that there wasn't any difference between that and osculation.
His voice must be peculiar. For the other afternoon, he spoke of Mr. Jetsam, and she fell into a swoon.
Another night she wept aloud and tore her flaxen tresses, because he hadn't mentioned her among the SOSs.
When she came to, this sentimental kid couldn't stand it any longer, and what do you think she did? Little Miss Bouncer wrote to the announcer down at the BBC.
The answer she received is worth reciting by return of post in plain handwriting.
All addressed and dated, this is what it stated.
Dear little Miss B.
Here's a picture of my babies, and the eldest is the laddie, who you may like to know is the image of his daddy.
To dear Miss Bouncer from the wife of the announcer, down at the BBC.
Flotsam and Jetsam with their classic tale of Little Betty Bouncer. Paragon Ragtime Orchestra with a favourite one-step called The Junk Man Rag. You know, couples first twirled around that tune in the year that the bodies of Captain Scott and his companions were found after their attempt to reach the South Pole. A certain Mrs. Pankhurst was accused of bombing Lloyd George's property, and another suffragette was killed as she fell in front of the King's Horse on the Derby racecourse. So the year for all that was 1913, when women's rights were far from what they are today. Now, my friends, a word in both your ears.
Hello, this is George Melly with an invitation to join me for a new series of Melly Talks Jazz, which starts on Tuesday night here on Radio 2. My guests over the next 6 weeks will include Sir Tim Rice, Marion Montgomery, and John Hendricks. But to start me up, I am joined by the Rolling Stones drummer Charlie Watts, less well known for his admiration of Eddie Compton, Louis Armstrong, and Vic Dickinson.
Louis Armstrong, to me, is one of the great, obviously, jazz trumpet player. He's also one of the great entertainers. And this particular period, I think he did both really well.
Join us for the new series of Melly Talks Jazz, the Jazz Chat Show, on Tuesday night at 10 here on Radio 2.
Desmond Carrington with your all-time greats. As the year 2000 draws to a close, I thought it might be appropriate to listen again to some of the artists we lost in the past 12 months. These snapshots of their work are by way of saying thank you for the pleasure they gave us. So first of all, a jazz piano player and vocalist who died in September at the age of 65. Tommy Burton delighted in performing Fats Waller numbers, and on this one I think he excelled himself.
Who's that walking round now, miss? Extremities really are obnoxious. Where'd you get them? Where did you get them? One never knows, do one?
The late Tommy Burton. echoing Fats Waller's record of Your Feet's Too Big, but making it into a very personal success. Personality is difficult to define, but Dame Barbara Cartland was a personality plus, whether or not you liked her pink clouds of romanticism. She once made a record album of words and music. Her words, but fortunately, other people's songs.
This song is full of very special memories for me. I did fall in love in Berkeley Square. I remember the scent of lilacs and syringa, the ancient houses silhouetted against the sky, the high trees overhead, the path leading towards a little temple in the centre of the garden. He was so handsome. We were both so in love with love. There was the magic of the night and of youth that can never come again except in our memories.
The movement lingered over London town. A puzzled moon, he wore a frown.
How could he know we two were so alone?
The whole damn world seemed upside down.
The streets of town were paved with stars. It was such a romantic affair. And as we kissed and said good night, a nightingale sang in Berkeley Square. I know, 'cause I was there that night in Berkeley Square.
Barbara Cartland doing her damnedest to improve on that standard ballad, but without success. I'm afraid for many, Dame Barbara was a snob, a privileged figure with jewels on her fingers and hair that looked rather like candy floss. But she was absolutely dauntless in whatever she attempted, whether that was flying gliders in the 30s or driving ambulances in wartime. She also wrote some 500 novels, most of which I believe had the same plot, but since I've not read any of them, I wouldn't really know. Just before Christmas... Ah, yes, I'm moving to someone else now. Just before Christmas, the man whom we knew as the singing postman died at the age of 73. If you ever heard him sing, you might have nailed up your letterbox.
I had a gal, a nice gal, down in Wroxham way. She wore holy nice to me back in the old school days. She would smile all the while, but Daddy didn't know all what she used to say to me behind the garden wall. Hey, I got a light, boy. Hey, I got a light. Molly Windley, she smoked like a chimney, but she's my little nicotine gal. Now you'll see her and me never more to part. We would wander hand in hand together in the dark. Then one night I held her tight in the old backyard. So when I try to hold her close, she say, now hold you hard. Hey, I got a light, boy. Hey, I got a light. Molly Windley, she smoked like a chimney, but she's my little nicotine girl. By and by, we decide on the wedding day. So we toddled off to church to hear the preacher say, do you now take this vow to honour all the time? Before I had the chance to stop her, she begins to pine. Hey, I got a light, boy. Hey, I got a light. Molly Windley, she smoked like a chimney, but she's my little nicotine gal. Now the doctor tells me a daddy I will be. So when I ask him what's the score, he say there's only three. So here I go, cheerio, to see how she do fare. I know what she will say to me as soon as I get there. Hey, I got a loop.
Allan Smethurst, the singing postman, as he was when he wrote and sang, Have You Got a Light Boy? Do you know, it is almost unbelievable, but that song won the Ivor Novello Award as the best novelty number of 1966. Allan Smethurst was a postman until his record made the hit parade, and then, for a while anyway, he was in the big time. So what happened to him afterwards? Well, he spent the last 20 years of his life living in a Salvation Army hostel in Grimsby, his earnings all spent on what he called expenses, fags and booze. Very sad. But he kept his Novello Award on display in his room. Now, someone who played tenor saxophone and sang with Glenn Miller's orchestra died last May. His name was Gordon Beneke, but everyone knew him as just Tex.
What you say?
Step aside, partner, it's my day. Bend an ear and listen to my version
of a really solid Tennessee excursion.
Pardon me, boy, is that the Chattanooga juju?
Yes, yes, track 29.
Boy, you can give me a shine.
Can you afford to board Chattanooga choo-choo?
I got my fare
and just a trifle to spare.
You leave the Pennsylvania station about a quarter to four, read a magazine and then you're in Baltimore.
Dinner in the diner, nothing could be finer
than to have your ham and eggs in Carolina.
When you hear the whistle blowing eight to the bar, then you know that Tennessee is not very far.
Shovel all the coal in, gotta keep it rolling.
Ooh, ooh, Chattanooga, there you are.
There's gonna be a certain party at the station.
Satin and lace.
I used to call Funny Face. She's gonna cry until I tell her that I'll never roam.
So, Chattanooga choo-choo,
won't you choo-choo me home?
Chattanooga, Chattanooga,
get aboard.
Chattanooga, Chattanooga,
all aboard.
Chattanooga, Chattanooga, Chattanooga choo-choo,
won't you choo-choo me home?
Chattanooga choo-choo.
Tex Beneke and the song that won for Glenn Miller the very first Gold Record Award ever in 1941, Chattanooga Choo Choo. Tex Beneke joined the Miller Band in 1938. He spent the rest of his life playing either Glenn's music or music in the Miller style with his own orchestra. It's possible that some of the people listening even talked with Tex Beneke via shortwave radio, because apparently he was a keen radio ham. He was 87 when he died last May. 45 years ago, one of the most prolific recording artists was Julie London, her smoky-voiced readings of song lyrics being reckoned to generate sufficient electricity to light up a town.
I saw you standing in the sun, and you were something to see. I know what I like, and I liked what I saw, and I said to myself, that's for me. A lovely morning, were quick to agree. You wanted to walk, and I nodded my head, and I breathlessly said, "That's for me." I left you standing under stars. The day's adventures are through. There's nothing for me but the dream in my heart, and the dream in my heart, that's for you. Oh, my darling, that's for you.
London, That's For Me, a song that Dick Hames introduced in the film musical State Fair. That was just one of literally hundreds of ballads that Julie London purred out in her sophisticated, very late-at-night voice, either accompanied by her then-husband Bobby Troop or by a solo guitarist. Julie also had a successful acting career in the 70s. She was one of the nurses in the American TV series Emergency. It's a pity we at Oxbridge never got her attached to our hospital. Julie London was 74 when she died last September. And you would have to be around that age to remember the name of Ernest Lough, but a record he made as a 15-year-old choir boy caused a sensation in 1927. Master Ernest Lough, with the choir of the Temple Church, London, and the record made 73 years ago of the Mendelssohn aria, Oh, for the Wings of a Dove. It was such a success, and so many copies had to be pressed, that the original master wore out, and in those days there was nothing for it but to record the piece all over again. So this was done. And usually it is that second recording that we hear today, but the finer version, in my view, the first version, when Ernest Lough's voice was pure silver, was what we heard today. Ernest Lough died last February. He would have been 90 this coming year. from Thielmann's Sossata's suite of Renaissance dances, the short piece called La Mourisque, in a version recorded by the Philip Jones Brass Ensemble. Philip Jones was one of the finest trumpeters ever to grace the British orchestral scene. He was with the orchestra at Covent Garden Opera House when he first formed a brass quintet, and over the subsequent years, that grew in expertise and refinement. Philip Jones realised that music made solely by brass instruments was a perfect form of expression for him, and through the many records that he and his ensemble made in the 1960s, his name became known throughout the world. He died almost a year ago, aged 71. Philip Jones. A lady who was never far from BBC studios during her career was Kay Cavendish, who sang to her own piano accompaniment.
Oh, mistress mine, where are you roaming? Oh, stay and hear your true love's coming, that can sing both high and low, and low. Oh, trip no further, journey's end in lovers meeting, every wise man's son doth know, doth know. What is love? 'Tis not hereafter, present mirth hath present laughter, what to come is near.
Cavendish, and a record when Dorothy Carless and Pat Rignold were with her as the Cavendish Three. Oh, Mistress Mine was part of a medley they called Shakespeare in Rhythm. Very charming, of course, as were all of Cavendish's offerings on radio and records. But I wonder if you ever saw her in an equally charming role as the BBC television announcer in programmes from Alexandra Palace, in 1939. It was Kay Cavendish who spoke the last words in Vision as the BBC television service closed down for some 7 years during the war. Kay Cavendish was 91 when she died last January. And Sir Jimmy Shand, the redoubtable purveyor of Scottish folk music on his accordion, was just 1 year older, 92, when he died a week ago.